Hey, good afternoon, everyone. I would like to thank Rama for giving me this opportunity to present my work to this audience. Thank you very much. I'm going to be talking about laboratory modeling of bistability in mid-latitude atmospheric jets. So it's a strongly geophysical application. This work has been done with David, my PhD student at IIT Madras, and my postdoc advisor, Joel Sumeria, in France. Okay, some overview on what distinguishes turbulence that you typically observe in geophysical systems. I'm specifically thinking of the atmosphere and the ocean. The flow is happening in very thin layers with respect to the radius of Earth, either the ocean or the atmosphere. So this puts them under the category of shallow water flows. Essentially, the length scales in the horizontal direction are much larger than the depth direction. And this, in the presence of Coriolis effects and barring baroclinic effects, the flows tend to be strongly two-dimensional. So there's a strong connection between shallow water flows and purely 2D Navier-Stokes equations. And from 2D turbulence, we are all aware of the energy cascade being in the opposite direction compared to the 3D turbulence. And one main consequence of this inverse energy cascade is that the energy accumulates into large-scale structures. So one very often observes formation of large-scale structures like jets and vortices. Here is one example from the atmosphere of Jupiter, a satellite image. I think we have seen it in at least a couple of talks in this meeting. So you see the great red spot, which is thought of as a giant vortex. You also see multiple layers of strong jets, and all thought to be a consequence of inverse energy cascade. Well, these large-scale structures are quite prominent in the atmosphere and the ocean too. Shown on the left is a wiki cartoon of the large-scale atmospheric currents that are known to persist. This strong red region is an eastward jet, so these are called westerlies, propagating from the west to east direction at some tropical latitudes, and they form as a result of differential heating between the equator and the North Pole and the Coriolis effects because of the Earth's background rotation. On the right is again a wiki cartoon of the large-scale currents that are present in the ocean. There are regions where these strong currents, velocities can be as large as 1 meter per second. There are some regions where they are present on the surface of the ocean. There are other regions where they are actually present as deep as 4 kilometers down. Now, the formation of these currents is another topic of hot debate. That's not my focus. I can give you a little flavor of what people think about. You have heat provided on the ocean surface from the sun. You have the Coriolis effects. But the most essential ingredient of forming such a large-scale ocean current system, where it's intensified in the deeper parts, is supply of heat somehow in the deeper oceans. And it's not very straightforward or obvious to know what are these mechanisms that supply heat in the deeper part of the oceans. So in a paper by Monk and Wunsch in the late 1990s, they identified winds that act on the ocean surface or the tides as the only two possible mechanical sources of this heat. But you still have to think about mechanisms by which the energy in winds or tides have to be converted into ultimate vertical mixing or heat. And this is thought to be achieved through internal wave generation and ultimate dissipation of these internal gravity waves. And that forms a significant part of the research that happens in my group. So what we are focused on today is not the formation mechanism of these large-scale structures, but a specific property, a phenomenon called bistability. Essentially, for any given set of parameters, they have two different stable states that can persist. And I'm going to specifically focus on abrupt qualitative changes in these large-scale structures. Well, we have seen this example too, so I included this slide quite in the last 1 hour or so, just so that it's put in the context of what's already been spoken about. The Earth's magnetic field is known to reverse in its polarity over timescales of 1 million years. And now it's understood to be, at least very many people believe, it's a result of the turbulent flow of an electrically conducting fluid in the Earth's core. Or as in this experiment, it was a turbulent flow of liquid sodium. What's plotted here is the magnetic field that's generated, spontaneously generated as a result of this turbulent flow. And you do see that there are times when the polarity or the sign of this magnetic field abruptly switches. They also report that the times over which the polarity remains more or less steady is always much longer than the time scale over which the switch from one state to the other happens. That's an interesting observation. And it's such a phenomenon that I'm interested in, but with respect to atmospheric jets. Here's another geophysical example where this abrupt changes happen. Here is one part of what I'm showing here is one part of this large-scale circulation system known as the Kuroshio current of the coast of Japan. So if you observe it during some periods, the periods are mentioned here, the mean path of this Kuroshio current is quite close to the Japanese coast. But during some other times, this is based on a combination of numerical models and observations, during some other times the jet meanders or deflects significantly from the coast. You plot a time series of the mean distance of the Kuroshio current from the coast. Yes, again, you observe abrupt changes in the distances, one corresponding to strong meandering, large values, or the other corresponding to sticking or not much meandering. All right? And these switches are seemingly random, and that's what we would like to simulate in a lab experiment. And as I will tell you in a later slide, we also are trying to put this in the context of theories based on statistical mechanics that my collaborators work on. So I would give you a brief overview on what are the essential mechanisms for the formation of these atmospheric jets and the possibility of bistability. So one always comes across the F and beta plane approximations. I'll just quickly tell you what they are. The Earth rotates about its axis, let's say the vector is little e with a magnitude omega. At any latitude on Earth, you decompose Earth's rotation into a component that is locally normal and another component that is in the tangent plane. It is believed in the ocean, one can make order of magnitude calculations to show that the tangential component of the Earth's rotation is at most occasions insignificant for the dynamics of the flow. This is sometimes referred to as the traditional approximation where you ignore the effects of omega y. So once, if you take omega z to be a constant, which is when we refer to it as an F-plane approximation, and that's essential for the formation of these eastward jets that I spoke about. But what's going to be important in our experiments is the variation of omega z as a function of latitude. In other words, at the pole, the local normal direction is entirely aligned with the Earth's rotation axis. At the equator, they are fully orthogonal. So this variation of omega z with latitude is an important effect, and that's what I refer to as the beta plane or the beta effect. Right? This, it turns out, by including the beta effect, allows for the mechanism for what are known as Rossby waves, something that an earlier speaker spoke about too in the context of the sun. All right, so what do? We are now going to focus on the atmospheric jet problem. The generation or some wavy patterns in the atmospheric jet itself was first simulated by Sumeria with his co-authors at UT Austin. So they simulate the problem in a rotating tank. They generate this eastward jet via a series of sinks and sources at this location at the bottom. So what they essentially do is suck fluid at the locations which are referred to as O, and the same amount of fluid is released at a larger radial location which is referred to as I. Strong rotation takes care of deflecting these jets in a azimuthal direction. So because this forcing itself results in a radial flow, Coriolis effects takes care of deflecting them in the azimuthal direction. And because it's a strongly rotating flow, if you look at the flow somewhere in the mid-plane of the tank, it's going to be mostly two-dimensional. To simulate the beta effect, the variation of omega z with latitude, you have a linear slope at the bottom of the tank. Right? So this is how you directly generate the eastward jet. But with the inclusion of a beta effect, you do see these strongly nonlinear Rossby waves that form on top of the jet. Quite happy saying some prominent features in the eastward jet has been reproduced here. Right? I didn't mention there are separate experiments that focus entirely on the formation of the eastward jet with the mechanism that coincides with that of Earth. So in those experiments, they heat the inner cylinder in this annular tank. And going towards the center is like going towards the poles, and they have a combination of this radial heating and Coriolis effects to explain the formation of these jets. So what are we interested in? A phenomenon that happens on these eastward jets, specifically what has come to be known as atmospheric blocking. So shown here are pictures from atmospheric observations. These lines can essentially be thought of as streamlines. Okay, so these are 10-day averages on during some specific periods. The jet stream is actually in a zonal state where there is hardly any deflection or meandering of its path. On a different period, you take a 10-day average of the data, you see the presence of these strong anticyclones, which end up strongly deflecting this main jet stream. They get strongly deflected towards the poles and has huge implications for what the weather patterns are like. Well, the same experimental setup that I showed in the previous slide, they tried to explain the presence of these two different stable states. So they said an important effect is the interaction of the jet with the topography that is presented by the continents. Right, so to roughly simulate the presence of the continents on top of the beta slope at the in the bottom of the tank, they added these two azimuthal topographies. So these topographies are present at the bottom of the tank. They allowed the jet to interact with the topography and saw whether they could observe both these states for the same parameters in the experiment. Indeed, they were able to observe something that looked like the zonal state. There's this correlation between this and this, and another state in which there are several anticyclones present, which again means there is strong deflection of this atmospheric current. They were quite happy, did not spend too much time on what the role of noise in triggering these transitions is, but they did observe spontaneous transition from one state to another. I should also point out that they did numerical simulations and could not quite easily get these spontaneous transitions, had to somehow include sufficient noise so that these transitions could be triggered. One of my focus in current research is to look at what the role of noise in triggering these transitions is. A brief motivation for why we are revisiting this problem. This comes from essentially Joel Somaria and Freddy Boucher. So here is the summary of results that appeared in PRL by Freddy Boucher and Eric Simone. They showed that if you have no dissipation, no forcing, 2D Navier-Stokes equations can be shown to undergo a second order phase transition using ideas from equilibrium statistical mechanics. I am no expert in statistical mechanics, but the two different states they talk about is one that looks zonal, the other dominated by the presence of a vortex. And the only difference between these two images is the aspect ratio of the doubly periodic domain they consider. Okay, but it's a second order phase transition which does not allow for two different states to be present for the same parameters. But then in this paper, they considered the stochastic Navier-Stokes equations. They added weak forcing and weak dissipation. The forcing contained some amount of randomness or stochasticity to it, and they were able to show that this phase transition now becomes first order, which then allows for the two different states to be present for the same parameters. Here is the statistics of how much time the system spends in the vortex-dominated state and the zonal state for two different aspect ratio of these boxes. The parameter need not be the aspect ratio alone. It could be the energy that's present in the turbulence or the extent of nonlinearity in the relation between pressure and stream function. So we are revisiting, essentially, we want to put our experimental results in the context of what's been achieved here. I should also point out 2D Navier-Stokes equations do have structural similarities to other models of the ocean, specifically the quasi-geostrophic or shallow water models. So these results are indeed relevant for at least some regimes in the ocean and the atmosphere. So what do? We have I do experiments in a rotating tank again, but now the eastward jet has been forced by a rotating annular lid. So this lid is in contact with the water surface as shown in the side view here. So we don't have these series of sources and sinks. We just wanted to more directly simulate or generate these eastward jets. There is a beta slope at the bottom, simulating the variation of omega z with latitude. And on top of the beta slope, we had a wave number one or an isolated topography. We are not that keen on exactly simulating the atmosphere. We are more keen on the fundamental aspects of these transitions. So we just put one topography on top of this linear slope. Is there anything else I want to say here? Yes, there is an azimuthal jet that is forced on the water surface, and then viscous processes decays these magnitudes of this jet, and by the time you get to the mid-plane, the jets are significantly weaker than what you're forcing here, but it's predominantly two-dimensional in this mid-plane that I'm indicating. for people who are interested in running experiments, the light sheet here has been generated by a rapidly rotating mirror, which I was quite fascinated by. So you have a light beam that's incident from above, incident on a rapidly rotating mirror that's an inclination of 45 degrees, ends up creating effectively horizontal light sheet. And you have a camera mounted on the rotating platform making measurements in the rotating frame. So here is a typical experiment. So what you do is seed the flow with glass particles. This is the raw movie that's obtained from the video camera. And you take these images and do what's called correlation image velocimetry to convert these to velocity fields. All right. So how did we start? We had no idea where the bistable regime is going to be. We didn't even know the different regimes that exist for the setup that we had built. So the first thing I did was to change the tank rotation from some specific small value to a large value. And the two control parameters in the experiment are the tank rotation and the lid rotation with respect to the tank frame. So that lid rotation omega, I'm keeping it fixed and increasing omega t slowly. And here you see a plot of the radial velocity as a function of the azimuthal coordinate at a fixed radius. It's somewhere in the middle of where the is being forced. So you plot the radial velocity in color as a function of omega t and the azimuthal coordinate. Well, to the visual eye, you do see three very different patterns, which right now I'm calling as states 1, 2, and 3. Zooming in further into the same experimental data, this is what you see. This is 1000 seconds of data about the states 1, 2, and 3. You see strongly propagating waves in state 2. So as such, we are quite happy to see this. At least there is something that resembles the zonal or a state that contains strongly propagating waves. The state 3 looks like the blocked state where at a given spatial location, the velocity is more or less constant, except for fluctuations that is present as a result of the turbulence. Well, you can plot the time series at a specific spatial location corresponding to states 1, 2, and 3, the strong oscillations that are present for state 2. And this is more or less constant except for these turbulent fluctuations in state 3. Okay, so then you construct from the instantaneous flow field, you construct the stream function, and you essentially play a movie over the entire visualization domain. So this is the equivalent of the pictures that I've shown in the previous slides. Yes, as the omega t is increased, so the tank rotation is being increased here, the omega r is held fixed, you do see transition to a clearly propagating state. And if you wait for long enough, you're going to see the blocked state where the entire flow field is more or less stationary except for the fluctuations present from the turbulence. And the block state is characterized with the presence of the strong vortex, which we wouldn't know from the previous Homwohler diagram. That's what was evident. That's the take-home message from this movie. All right, we spent quite a bit of time trying to come up with a single number that quantifies which state we are in. To the visual eye, it's quite easy to see there are patterns in the azimuthal velocity profile. It was not so easy to get a single number. We have spent a lot of time doing it, and final quantity that we have agreed on is essentially the simplest quantity we could think of, which is the RMS of the radial velocity fluctuations. So in a strongly wave propagation state, you expect this value to be large, because there's large amplitude oscillations. And in the blocked state, this is going to be quite small. And that's what I plot here. The RMS of the radial velocity fluctuations, again, as a function of azimuthal coordinate at a fixed radial location, as a function of omega t, relatively small values in the beginning, which is what I call state 1, then larger values in the propagating state 2, and back to, again, relatively smaller values in the blocked state 3. There is some dependence on the rate at which I increase the tank rotation rate in my experiments. The transition points do vary a little, specifically the transition to the propagating state, as you see with the dashed lines here. This transition from the propagating to the blocked state seems relatively insensitive to the rate at which I increase omega t. then the natural next thing to do is to start with initial conditions for at large omega t and decrease the tank rotation, which is exactly what we did. And the point at which we switched from the state 3, the block state, to the propagating state that's characterized by large values for this quantity happens much, much later than in the ramp-up experiments. This is well known as hysteresis, where we have ended up identifying a specific range of values for omega t over which both the propagating and the blocked states are possible. In which state you are in depends on the initial condition that you have chosen in the experiments, and we think strongly dependent on the noise present in the experiments. Well, to be sure, this is indeed a topography effect. We got rid of the azimuthal topography, and I have not analyzed this flow in great detail, just that we verified that there is no hysteresis or bistability possible without the topography. Well, this flow field here without the topography is essentially an eastward jet containing strongly nonlinear Rossby waves. We did not spend too much time analyzing this flow. So in summary, there is no hysteresis when there is no topography, then there is a transition from states 1 to the propagating state 2 to the block state 3 as omega t is increased. The point at which this transition happens seems to depend significantly on the rate at which omega t was increased in the experiments. And in the ramp down experiments, you see the transition from the block state to the propagating state occurring at very different values when you compare it with the ramp up experiment. Again, this transition point seems to depend on the rate at which you change the system parameter. Is there anything else I want to add here? Yes, there are these individual points indicate experiments where the parameters in the experiment were held fixed, and they are going to lie either on the ramp up curve or the ramp down curve. That's kind of a validation for assuming the flow to be quasi-steady in the ramp-up or ramp-down experiments. Okay, so what did we do next? We wanted to go to the bistable regime. So that's one such point in the bistable regime, and actually characterize these two different states in great detail. So I'll play the raw movies corresponding to the blocked state and the propagating state. So let me recall, this is exactly the same system parameters in the two experiments, as the initial conditions in the experiments or the path through which we got to these system parameters are different in the two experiments. The block state is characterized by a strong vortex. In this experiment alone, because of practical difficulties, I had to do a clockwise tank rotation and a clockwise lid rotation, which corresponds to again an eastward jet. And this cluster that you see indicative of a vortex is just downstream of the azimuthal topography. You don't see such a vortex present in the propagating state. So that's what the raw movies look like. Even at this stage, they are quite different. One can plot the time series. Again, owing to practical difficulties, I was not able to make measurements on the entire domain at one go. So we had to do two separate experiments and then stitch the two data up to get the velocity profile over the entire azimuthal coordinate at a fixed radial location. You see these strongly propagating waves in the propagating state, and more or less blocked or a steady flow field with some turbulent fluctuations in the blocked state. This is what the mean flow field looks like in the two different states. This is almost axisymmetric, and the block state is characterized by the presence of a strong vortex just downstream of this azimuthal topography. Yes, so but what were we looking for? My motivation is to look at abrupt transitions between these two states. I spent several night outs and there were no spontaneous transitions. And given previous experiments reported spontaneous transitions, we thought it was going to happen, and I was already planning on taking statistics. Never happened. Turns out it's possibly because we had changed the mechanism by which we were generating this eastward jet, and that ended up cutting down on the noise that is present in the forcing. What we think is the explanation. So there were no spontaneous transition, but I wanted to generate some transition before my postdoc ended. So I gave a sudden noise to the system. So you will achieve some state and then suddenly abruptly change the tank rotation to a very different value, still within the bistable regime. right? And there were some experiments where we observed the transitions here from the propagating state to the block state. And there were other experiments where the same amount of noise over the same time scale, but then the transitions did not occur. Or at least there is some dependence on the noise levels in the system that we see determining whether the transition from the block to the propagating state or vice versa would happen or not. So this is where I will end my talk. Our current efforts are towards a detailed understanding of the role of amplitude, spatial, and temporal scales in the noise. This could either be in the external forcing, for example, in the forcing that I provide on the rotating the lid on the surface of the water, or the noise that is inherently present in the turbulent flow. And so I've not shown a lot of data that ended up triggering no transitions. We have tried many different things in triggering these transitions. One other effort we did was to introduce structures or introduce cylindrical topography in the tank that would simulate vortex shedding downstream of the cylinder, and then seeing if the turbulence in that cylinder wake could induce transitions. Not so successful, but this is exactly what we are up to in the lab at IIT Madras. And we are also in discussions with Freddie and Joel on how to put these results in the context of large deviation theory, which I'm not an expert on. I only know the details that are sufficient to motivate what I should look for in the experiments. Thank you very much.
Thank you for the nice talk. Any questions?
Thanks, Mani. In the slide where you show the hysteresis, there's a column D there, which seems to take seems to be quieter for a longer time. I just wanted to know the difference between the hysteresis when you show the hysteresis. This one.
Yeah.
What's the difference between C and D?
The rate at which omega T was decreased.
Which is slower?
Huh?
Which one?
Which one is slower? Actually, I don't know right now. Let's go to the other plot. There's, that information is present in the 1D plots. So the rates at which omega T was decreased is present here. So you see so these are the ramp down experiments. And red, green, so green is larger than red. Green greater than blue, greater than red. Green greater than blue, greater than red. So it doesn't have an intuitive pattern. In fact, the intermediate, the green is the largest rate, but the transition point seems to be intermediate between the other two rates. So I don't think I understand what determines exactly this transition point.
And the other question was, so in the absence of topography, this switch does not happen, right? Does that
in
have
In the
some?
Absence of topography, there is no hysteresis, yes. But it's not even clear. It's not clear if there is a clear blocked state in the absence of topography.
So I wanted to ask, does that have any relation to like the circumpolar current where you have, you know, it's all ocean and no continent, and the current doesn't have to navigate past something? Is there a relation to the stability of that versus the some current that has to go over continents?
There is some relation to that. In fact, another direction in which we are going is to look at how these transition points are related to the stability of the vortices that form. I cannot fully answer your question, but that's a direction we have in mind to relate these transition points, what determines these transition points and the associated stability of the vortices that are a big feature of the blocked states. I agree with you. Okay. I see. So, thanks for the comment. Uh-huh. Okay. 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 Yeah. I will look for it. We have not done that. So I also have to be aware of the temporal resolution. That should be sufficient to resolve the tank rotation. I will look for it. Thank you.
Yeah. Hi. Have you considered temperature variations as a means to induce the transition?
It's something we can think of, but right now, no.
Because in cases of swirling jets, people have observed bistability, and the transition was spontaneous when temperature variations were present.
I see. So we just wanted to keep things simple.
Okay.
Something we can think of. Thank you. Yes.
You had a jet in the northern hemisphere?
Yeah.
Is there one in the southern hemisphere too?
Yes. Yes, more or less similar stuff happened in the southern hemisphere too.
Okay, let's thank the speaker. Thank you.